Hello folks, today's video is going to be with Courtney Applewhite, who is a student, and what she's going to do very kindly today is share how she uses Obsidian. Now this has been available inside the Obsidian course for a couple of weeks now. You can check that out in the link in the description, but a huge thanks to Courtney for coming here on the channel. Hello everyone and welcome back to the Keep Productive YouTube channel. It is Francesco here. Today we're very lucky to be joined by Courtney Applewhite, who is going to be diving into her Obsidian account. So Courtney, maybe you can introduce yourself a little bit more about what you're studying and what you're working on at the moment.
Sure. So I'm a PhD student at the University of California, Santa Barbara. I've just completed my qualifying exams in religious studies. That's what I'm studying. I specifically work on North American religious traditions, but my focus is on death rituals within the contemporary United States. So that's my area of study. I just completed my qualifying exams, and that's what I've been using my Obsidian account for most recently, because that takes up 100% of my time.
I bet, yeah. That's quite an upbeat topic, isn't it? How did you get into that in the first place, just out of curiosity?
Sure. So I worked at the medical examiner's office out of college. I worked as a death investigator. So that is the person hits, it's sort of like the coroner's office. So we go to scenes of unexpected or sometimes, you know, violent deaths and record information and bring that person back to the medical examiner's office. So I worked, that was my work for several years.
Wow.
And I decided to go back to get the PhD in order to learn a little bit more about the ritualization process. I specifically look at people who are not necessarily religious. So the religious studies department is a funny fit for me, but, So I'm looking at how people are making sense of those moments that I sort of witnessed firsthand. So that's where how I transitioned.
Wow. So a lot of sort of studying, a lot of information sort of coming your way. And my first question is more about, like, how did you find Obsidian? Because there are obviously a lot of talk around other apps like Roam and things like that. How did you pick the one of Obsidian from all of those?
Well, this was a really challenging process for me. I was actually originally recommended Roam. So I took a look at that, and that was just from, I was listening to productivity podcasts like your own, and I was sort of trying to decide how I wanted to manage, because in the qualifying exam process, I had to read approximately 300 items, books and articles, and then sit for three separate written exams where I was given a set of questions and then asked to reproduce certain amounts of knowledge from that set of data. Mm-hmm. So it was a huge amount of information, and I was in the midst of it when I realized I wasn't managing it well. I didn't have clear access to it. I had it in, like, each of the books and articles were noted in separate Google Docs, and they weren't talking to each other, and I was having trouble making sense of it. So I was listening to these productivity podcasts, and a lot of people were saying knowledge management, you know, look at Roam. And so I started to look at Roam. And I watched a lot of those sort of comparative YouTube where they're looking at all the different knowledge management tools. I landed on Obsidian in one sense, because I'm a bit paranoid and I wanted to be sure that I had these notes. It was so critical for me to, like, maintain them. So I wanted them locally stored. And then I also backed them up using my Google Drive. So that was like a double, I was able to back them up, but I wanted them to also be locally stored. And then I liked the interface a little bit more. I played around with Roam a little bit. I got I think they offered like a free trial, so I was able to take a look at it. And I sort of was more attracted to the interface for Obsidian. And I recognize that, I think that I also just felt a little bit more comfortable with the way that people were talking about using Obsidian, like on the different boards. Roam cult felt a little like a lot for me, for being like a first timer, I guess, in the knowledge management world. Obsidian felt a little bit more sort of not as intense in some ways. Like, I felt like I could just use it without really joining Roam cult, and maybe there's a reason that that's a thing. But so that's just sort of how I decided on it. It did what I needed it to do. It was stored locally, and I really enjoyed the interface.
Sure, brilliant. Yeah, I mean, I'm curious, like, did you ever use like a note-taking app or another thing? You mentioned Google Docs, but did you use something, because you, like, I don't know whether it's the same in the US, but you do like your PhD later on, but you do like your bachelor's before, is it? It's the same over there. Did you use like a note-taking app before then?
No, I had a bit of a gap between my bachelor's and my PhD, and although I'm sure there were, I graduated college in 2014, and there weren't quite as many of these sort of next generation note taking apps. In college, I used a combination of like, you know, Word documents and physical notebooks, which has been horribly tedious later on, just getting all that information back into like any sort of like computer without hauling around like 400 notebooks. So I really didn't. I kind of transitioned from not using any sort of note taking online or digital note taking method apart from Word documents, and sort of jumped right into this.
So you can definitely see the change from that Word document environment to this, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Brilliant. Courtney, would you be kind enough to show us a little bit more about how you use Obsidian?
So sure. So this is the graph view. I think that this is pretty cool. I used this when I was doing my review cycle. So just to sort of overview like how I use this particular page, I use this during the review cycle because each of these giant nodes that you see here are components of questions that I was going to be asked. So I was given some sort of foresight into the types of questions that was asked for my qualifying exams. And so these are subsections of each of those questions. And so you have like, I was going to be asked about spiritual, secular, and religious people and the differences and similarities between them. So this hub is spiritual. And it's linked to the book and article notes that I thought were relevant to that topic. And then those books speak to other articles or in conversation with other articles. And so as I was going through and doing my review cycle where I was trying to make sense of these things, I would sort of use this as to sort of think about, okay, like who was in conversation with who during this? What were they saying? And so I used it in that way to sort of make those connections as I was thinking through how I would answer these types of questions. And then, so just to backtrack a little bit, I used this question analysis. So this is, I think that this is fairly a fairly common setup. These are like maps of content, and I didn't really name them as such, but I've sort of borrowed this idea from productivity circles, and I sort of used this to outline this question analysis to outline what I thought the different subsections of each question would be. These are the names of my Joe, David, and Anne are the names of my advisors. So each of them are going to ask me a set of questions, and so I broke down what I thought the most likely aspects of those questions would be. And so then on my bar over here, I sort of just made little pages for each of them. So these are the top sort of has the questions that I think were going to be asked. And then this page was actually created last. So after I had compiled all of my notes and articles and books, I basically began compiling how I would answer those questions in these sort of like map of content areas. So we have things like spiritual, secular, secularization. So these are all things that I thought I would be asked, and with the accompanying notes. And you can sort of see on the sidebar here that I have all of them linked. And so what I would do is the book notes themselves were tagged in this way. So for example, I'm just going to click over, and this one was tagged under secularization, and I have like hashtags throughout that sort of give me more specifics about that. And so whenever I was compiling how I would answer the question, if we go back to secularization, I would sort of click over to these, you know, if I would split screen and sort of click over to these to sort of see how they might fit into this larger question that I'm building. And I do this sort of with each of these subsections of those questions. Find another one that's actually filled out here. So this is another example. So I have the question at the top. I see that there's linked mentions over here. So I just sort of click over and figure out how I want to incorporate this particular note into this question. And what I tend to do, you can sort of see me doing it here, is I basically boil down what I think the most salient parts of this larger note are into my map of content. As I continue to refine this, what I'll likely do is create sort of very short summaries at the top. I sort of ran into a time constraint with taking my exams, but in an ideal scenario, I'd sort of already have like a quick summary of these book notes sort of at the top that I could then easily transfer into sort of questions. And that's how I was using it. I built out all the questions in these maps of content, and then that gave me a place to, so then I would review that, go back through and fill out what I thought were the salient parts of each of those articles that were tagged and or backlinked. And then whenever I actually came to do my exam, I sort of already had, I knew, I didn't have these notes available to me, but I had already compiled them in a way that I was able to remember.
Sure. And just out of curiosity, did you like follow some sort of process from somebody in the productivity space to organize this layout? Or was it something that sort of naturally came to you when you were setting things up?
Sure. So I owe basically this entire setup to at Cal Historian. So if he listens. Okay. So I got on the Discord channel for Obsidian, because I was trying to figure out the most sensible way to go about, because this is just a massive amount of data. I have something like, I think there's easily over like 250 notes here. Wow. And there's just so much data, and I just didn't really know how to organize it. But I believe he's also a scholar, because he was sort of speaking from that experience, and he recommended this kind of setup. So I really went off of his recommendation from the Discord conversation that we had and was able to build it out in this way. And then I sort of just refined it specifically. He gave me sort of the idea for having the maps of content, breaking down the questions, and then I sort of refined it using my own sense of how I wanted it to be backlinked, how I wanted them to communicate with each other, and then the addition of tags and things like that.
Fantastic. And out of curiosity, when it comes to like the revision aspect of it, do you use the graph view for that when you're like looking at particular subjects, or is it just like opening up loads of different notes and sort of navigating it like that?
I use the graph view. I actually did use the graph view a lot. I found it pretty valuable. I'll just bring it back up here. It doesn't look like it's almost became very cluttered at the end, because there's just so many things here and they're like really well organized. But yeah, so what I would basically do is I would come over here and sort of grab the spiritual, for example, and then I would try and, you know, just basically looking at that, sort of give myself an overview of the kind of answer that I would give for this. So I would say like, okay, so I see the, you know, Carrot and King article, which is a critique of the notion of spirituality. And I was like, who else was critiquing spirituality? And I would try to quiz myself before I gave myself like a clear line to that and say, so if someone's going to ask me about the critique of spirituality, who else would I wrap in there, and then sort of quiz myself and say, oh, okay, so Mark Singleton also has this critique, Jeffrey Kripal, that I can also see how that's connected to secularization. And then I would try to jump to that and just have like a fluidity, because there's two components to the qualifying exam. There's the writtens, and then you have to do an oral defense. So I wanted to be ready, start preparing myself for both the fluidity in my thinking as I was going to need to answer the written exams, but also being able to have that conversation in mind as I go to defend when they're going to be asking me questions about the things that I've responded to. So I wanted to be able to do both of those things. So that's sort of how I use this. I sort of just used it as a way to quiz myself, because it blanks it in a way, right? So you can sort of see mine in particular is pretty cluttered. So I can't really see, like, for example, who, you know, this one here, Saba Mahmood, is talking to. So that's a way for me to quiz myself before I shoot over to her little bubble. So I did try to do that, to have that fluidity.
I could definitely see why it would help with fluidity in terms of the studying, because it definitely links everything up nice visually. I'm curious, like, what you would recommend for, say, a student that's watching this, or someone who's maybe a researcher, about how to get started. Would you recommend, say, a set process, or like exploring themselves? Like, do you have any recommendations if you were to put yourself in their shoes?
Sure. So I'm probably drawing both from the fact that I do teach and my experience with Obsidian here, but I think it's really useful for students particularly to begin with the end in mind. So if possible, sort of determine the kind of the kind of knowledge retrieval you're going to have to be doing. So for example, if you're using this tool for studying for a test, knowing if you're going to have a multiple choice test or an essay test and starting from there, because I think that will kind of determine how you might break down different kinds of information.
Sure.
So I think that that's always like a strong place to start. And so for example, if a student was using this to build out for a multiple choice test or a fill in the blank test kind of thing, and they know the content ahead of time, maybe they have chapters in a book or something like that. I think it's sensible to start with like maps of content that are larger. And like, for example, a chapter that has like a particular subject heading, and then breaking it down sort of as you need by smaller subjects. So that's sort of how I started as well. You know, if you notice on the sidebar here, I sort of started with 0, 1, 0, and then I went up to 0, 1, 2, 0, but I had to fill in. So then this section has 0, 5, 0, 0, 5, 5, 0, 5, 6, 0, 5, 7, yeah. Because I had refined meetings that then broke down the questions a little bit further. Yeah. So I think that that's a place that you can start, and researchers in the same way. I think that you sort of begin all your research processes with like a research question and breaking down the aspects of that question to understand what kind of knowledge you need to put into the different elements. So I think in that sense, you could have a section that's about your methodology. You could have a section that's about, you know, the lit review you're going to have to do. That's what I think that, you know, sort of jumping ahead a little bit, this particular graph that I have here is going to be really useful for whenever I am creating new content for literature reviews and things like that, because it has, if I'm writing an article about spirituality, I have a node here that specifically speaks to that.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, from a project to project basis, that's sort of how you can think about it. And with larger content, larger knowledge management, I think that it's just, you just sort of expand that same framework, maybe.
Sure. I love the idea of like thinking of the end before you start, which is good because that like that sets you on the right route. And I guess my final question is more around like, do you use it in a personal context as well as say like a journal, like a personal note taker or anything like that?
Yes, I'm starting to. So I'm working on, I found that this process for me was a little easier than incorporating into, because I've never really used like a workflow. This is something that's not, I mean, it's not really popular in academia, I would say, and maybe some academics will fight me on this, but I think that productivity is something that's kind of new to academic circles. And so there's not a lot of examples of how academics use it. So it's sort of like an adaptation, but we're actually well suited to, because like many people who are entrepreneurs or self-starters, we do a lot, we are very self-directed in our work. We're sort of choosing our own projects. And so I think it's a really valuable tool. So I'm still learning how to do that. I do have a personal one that I'm starting to work on that has my sort of maps of content for personal areas of my life. And then, or like my personal, look more personal recreational knowledge management. So things about sports and like things like that.
Yeah.
And I'm starting to do a sort of daily process where I sort of have my tasks and to-do lists, and I'm starting to incorporate that as well. I have more time to play with it now that this larger project is done.
That's it. Yeah. You've got this vault done.
Yeah,
now it's time to done. Like relax right. It. I absolutely love the way you've set things up, and it's definitely given me a few ideas for sure in terms of like setting up something like this. But thank you so much for coming on, Courtney. Is there anywhere, like, I don't know whether you want people to follow you after or anything like that. Is there anywhere people can discover how you obviously through the likes of Twitter, that's how we found each other, right?
Yeah. So I'm at C Applewhite X on Twitter. I can't say that I'm a reliable tweeter, but you're welcome. You're welcome to follow me there. And that's probably the best place to find me.
Absolutely smashing. Thank you, Courtney, for taking your time out.
Yeah, absolutely. Happy to be on.